There have been many events and celebrations this year to mark the anniversary of the NHS, but there are not many doctors who were there from the very beginning and are still working. Dr. Neville Davis is one such doctor, and he's here to tell us about his career and experiences. Hello, thank you for having us in this beautiful house. Yeah. So you were there from the very beginning. You qualified just before the NHS was formed. Right. But let's just start from now, from the end. You're still working.
One of the ways I expanded my career, if you like, was to take up medical legal matters. And I still act as an expert witness in crimes and sexual crimes and just assaults. It keeps my brain active, and I think that's important.
That's very important. That's wonderful. Mm. And more recently, the Sunday Mirror gave you the title of being the oldest practicing or working doctor in the country. Is that right?
I'm certainly not the oldest practicing doctor because I don't practice, but as far as working, it's a possibility. Although I heard of a chap in the States who's 106 and still going strong.
Right. Oh, so you still have some competition.
Yes.
Okay, so it would be really interesting to hear about the NHS then and now. Tell us a little bit about, you know, the major differences that you've experienced over the years.
Well, I can only compare and contrast on the basis that I was a practicing doctor in the early years, right up to perhaps turn of the century. But as I grew older, of course, becoming very much of a patient.
Right.
You know, it's a natural thing. So that's how I'm experiencing the NHS now. I've had a lot of experience of it now. On the other side of the divide.
Okay, but you obviously still have the perspective of being a physician
as
well.
Yes, I do. I mean, it's quite interesting when I think back. For example, as a GP, now I did my hospital jobs first of all, and then I started in practice in 1950. I started a practice in London. And I began to get very interested in mental health. And I was very much influenced by a Hungarian psychiatrist called Michael Balint, who in 1957, wrote a book, The Doctor, His Patient and the Illness. And it dealt very much, for example, with the doctor's own feelings, which he may not have been aware of.
Right.
And one case comes back to me very much because we used to go to the Tavistock Clinic in London for seminars where groups of doctors would talk about their patients. And I remember on one occasion I talked about a patient to Michael Barlint, and I thought this guy was gay. Now we're talking pre-1967. I was a police surgeon at that time as well, so police surgeons also had to do funny jobs like looking at the anuses of these people who were charged with importuning in public lavatories. So it's very peculiar. Anyway, this chap was coming to me quite often. He was obviously extremely depressed, and I couldn't get anywhere with this guy. Couldn't really communicate with him at all. So I brought this case up to Michael Barlint. Michael said to me, Neville, tell me about the disposition of your consulting room. What's the relationship between you and the patient and the desk and all the rest of it? I said, well, I've got a lovely rosewood desk. I sit on one side of it and he sits on the other. I said, Michael, and he said, when he talks to you, Neville, how do you react? And I thought about this and I said, well, probably lean back a bit and think, you know. Oh dear, he said, next time, Neville, lean forward, just see what happens. The next time this guy came in, he spoke to me, and I did lean forward, and he seemed to be much more open. And then he seemed to be on the verge of telling me something. I got up, went round, put my arm around him, and he burst into tears. And everything came out, and from that moment on, he was getting better. So that was the sort of thing that we used to do in those days.
And that's the sort of thing that doctors today cannot possibly do. A doctor, a GP, will not come and put their arm around the shoulder of the patients, would they?
I'd be worried that there'll be an action against him on that account. I mean, The other thing is that we really had much more laxity of the way we behaved and the way we were with patients. We weren't constrained so much by time. I also worked with a Hungarian psychiatric social worker who eventually got a professorship in Canada, and I think we were the first. We published a letter in The Lancet. I think we are certainly among the first relationship between a psychiatric social worker and a GP in the country. Very interesting stuff.
So would you say that GPs then had more freedom to use their intuition and to invest more time in their patients than they are today?
Yes. I think that the day of the individual doctor, the personal doctor, is over. I felt that it was becoming restrictive, if you like. The freedom to be with the patient as you felt you wanted to be in your when you had the ideas of what the patient needed and what you could give, that was one thing. But when you're told what to do,
right,
it may be okay.
Right. Is it true that one major difference between then and now is that doctors in the 50s would offer a cigarette to their patients?
Oh, gosh, I always smoked in the surgery.
You did?
I always asked permission first, and then if permission was given, I'd offer the patient a cigarette, and the patient would often take it.
So did you not know that smoking was...
This was before the Richard Dole business, and... we all smoked. The senior surgeon at Guy's, where I trained, one of the senior surgeons, a professor, he was notorious for this. He would do his operation, he would leave the registrars to sew up, and he would walk out of the operating theatre.
And have a fag.
And the theatre sister had to have a lighted cigarette ready to put in his mouth.
It's like something out of comedy.
Well,
really.
not so much of a comedy. I qualified in 48.
Which is the year in which the NHS was established.
In 1973 or 4, I went back to Guy's just for a visit, and I met there a chap who in my day was a junior porter or something or other. He was now head porter, and we knew each other well. And I said to him, "Hello, and how are you?" He said, "Why are you here?" So I said, "I'm here to see Sam." Sam was the name of the professor. He said, "Don't you know?" I said, "Don't I know what?" He said, "Sam's dead. Sam died from a secondary in his brain from a carcinoma of lung, just like you're going to get, you silly so-and-so." And I put my cigarette out, and I've never had one since.
Today, a lot of people are complaining about lack of funding, in the NHS. How was it at the beginning? Were doctors happy to be part of the service, or were there complaints?
Yes, I mean, it was a great social experiment, apart from anything else. There never was, I don't think there was ever enough money. And sometimes it reached the stage where doctors, for example, felt like packing it in.
Oh, really? So,
yes.
Okay, even then morale wasn't always high.
Morale wasn't good at times. In fact, at times it was very bad.
So, having seen the whole story, as it were, do you have any tips, both as a practitioner and as a patient, to the NHS for the future?
Well, I think what the NHS is doing now, with the resources available to it, is absolutely wonderful. I can't praise them sufficiently, because that's from my own viewpoint of how they've treated my family and myself. Nothing but praise there, but they need all the help they can get. And in particular, I think they need the relationship between social services and NHS to be closer than ever.
Right.
I think that would help a great deal.
And one final thing, just from a personal... well, I'm interested. What's the secret of staying so young and fit and active at the age of 93? Is it working or what?
I think it's good peasant stock.
Okay, we can't all have control over that one. But thank you so much. It's been wonderful to speak to you.
Yeah, thank you very much.